हेलो क्लास 12th, वेलकम बैक टू अवर चैनल शिक्षक जंक्शन, क्योंकि अब नहीं तो कब। नाउ फ्रॉम दीज लेक्चर्स, कुछ लेक्चर्स के लिए वी आर मूविंग फ्रॉम अवर डिजिटाइज टू अवर डिजिटाइज बोर्ड, इनफैक्ट फ्रॉम अवर ट्रेडिशनल ब्लैक और द वाइट बोर्ड दैट वी वर यूजिंग इन अवर लेक्चर्स, बिकॉज फ्रॉम दीज लेक्चर्स देर आर सम कॉम्प्लिकेटेड फिगर्स विच आर नीड टू बी एक्सप्लेन एंड दैट विल बी ईजियर वेन यू विल स्टडी दैट थ्रू द डिजिटाइज बोर्ड दैट वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी फ्रॉम दीज लेक्चर्स, राइट। सो एज इट इज वेरी ऑब्वियस फ्रॉम द फिगर इट सेल्फ वॉट वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस फ्रॉम दीज लेक्चर्स इज दिस मेल रिप्रोडक्ट system, right? It is very clear from the figure also that we are going to discuss this particular part in this particular lecture, and I have already explained you regarding the accessory organs and the primary organs, so without wasting much of that time in explaining again those things, we will directly move on to the special organs that are included within this particular male reproductive system, right? Now, first of all, the primary sex organ that is there within this male reproductive system is this testis. Now, what actually is the testis that you can understand from the figure, right? From the figure, there is a highlighter and this is this. See, it is written here the testicle. This oval round shaped organ, which is very clear in the figure, is nothing but the testis. This is the primary sex organ which is involved in the male reproductive system. Now, coming on to the special features of this particular testis. It is, as it is obvious from the figure itself, it is oval in shape, right? You can very well see in that, in this picture also. Now, what is special feature of this testis is, this testis is located outside the abdominal cavity of the males, right? Why it is located, that we are going to discuss, but yes, it is located outside the abdominal cavity, where in the specialized pouches that is known as scrotum. Why this testis is located within the scrotum? It is because the maturation of the sperms, you have to note it down very carefully or listen to it very carefully, the maturation of the sperms require the temperature of 2 to 2.5 degrees Celsius lower than that of the body. This particular arrow denotes this, that the temperature that is required for the motility of sperms is 2 to 2.5 degrees Celsius lower. That is why they are located within the scrotum, that is the specialized pouches outside the abdominal cavity, right? So this is the special feature of this testis. Now, coming on to this very particular organ, testis, this testis is covered by three dense coverings. Now we are going towards the inside and we are going to study the internal structure of testis. So this testis is covered by three dense coverings, in fact, and these dense coverings are, what are they known as? This tunica word is common among all the three. Now, what is difference is the name that comes the later. The very first is the tunica vaginalis. I know the names are a little bit difficult, but no other option, you have to learn that, right? The first covering is tunica vaginalis. Next, second covering is tunica again remains the same. It is tunica albuginea, right? Third layer, tunica, this tunica is same among all these, right? Tunica vasculosa, these are the three layers that are there present within the testis, or the testis is covered by these three dense layers. What are they? Tunica vaginalis, next is tunica albuginea, and then comes tunica vasculosa. Right? Now what happens is this very particular layer, that is the tunica albuginea. Wait, I'll just change the color so that you can have a good idea of how it is going to be. Right? Now, so this tunica, this tunica albuginea then divides further, or it divides the testis into some 200 to 300 compartments, right? What it does, this tunica albuginea divides the testis into some 200 to 300 compartments, and these compartments are known as testicular lobules. See, if you remember it in the form of flowchart or the way I am explaining to you, it becomes very easy for you to remember. So, this tunica albuginea, which is one of the membrane or one of the dense covering of the testis, divides further into 200 to 300 compartments, that is known as this testicular lobules. Right? Now, further division takes place. These testicular lobules gets divided. Each testicular lobule divides to form, say, how does it divide? It divides to form 1, 2, 3 highly coiled tubules that are known as seminiferous tubules. Okay, what happens? See, this tunica albuginea divides to form 200 to 300 compartments within the testis, that is known as testicular lobules, and each testicular lobule further divides to form 1 to 3 seminiferous tubules. Now, further division takes place. The division or the anatomy of this particular primary sex organ is somewhat difficult, or you can say somewhat complex. Why? Because it has to manufacture, it has to synthesize the sperm, which are ultimately the male gametes, and which leads to the fertilization. That means that leads to the continuation of our generation. So the difficulties will be there, or the complexities will be there. You have to learn at anyhow. Tunica albuginea, it has divided into 200 to 300 compartments that are known as testicular lobules, and each testicular lobule gives rise to 1 or 3 seminiferous tubules. Now what happens is the further division of this seminiferous tubule, very important thing about the seminiferous tubule is it is lined by a germinal epithelium. You all might be aware of what this germinal epithelium is. It is a kind of layer of cell that makes the seminiferous tubule. So 1, 2, 3 seminiferous tubules, each tubule is lined by a germinal epithelium, and it further contains the two types of cells. Now what these cells are that we are going to study. Okay. Now, what these cells are, first of all, very important point, color change, right? Yes, now. Okay, so how this seminiferous tubule is going to be divided? This seminiferous tubule that we have seen gets divided into two parts. How it gets divided? It gets divided into two types of cells actually. What are these cells? Very simple, that you all have studied in your earlier classes. The very first type of cell that it divides is these germ cells, or the cells which gives rise to the gametes, and second one is these somatic cells. Okay. Now, what happens with these germ cells? These germ cells are in fact the spermatogonic cells. Why they are called as spermatogonic cells? Because these cells gives rise to the gametes, which are the sperms. Now how they give rise? With the help of the mitosis, and the meiosis division, the meiosis and the mitotic divisions takes place, oh, there should be meiosis, yes, it takes place in these germ cells, which leads to the formation of the male germ cells or the male gametes that are termed as the sperm. So this is how these germ cells function. Now, if germ cells' role is to form the gamete, ultimately these somatic cells are present in order to provide the nourishment. Nourishment to what or to whom? Nourishment to the germ cells or the developing sperms. This is the role of these seminiferous tubules. Okay, that is why these seminiferous tubules are present, and they are divided into two types, germ cells and somatic cells, right? Now, a very important point regarding this seminiferous tubule is, we have studied in our previous slide that each testicular lobule gets divided into 1, 2, 3 seminiferous tubule. Now, these seminiferous tubules are separated from each other by means of some other cells. Okay, what are the some other cells that because of which they are separated? Those particular cells are known as a very important again. Why? Because they produce a special kind of hormone that is there. Okay. What these cells are called? They are called as the Leydig cells. What are these Leydig cells? Leydig cells are those cells by which 1 to 3 seminiferous tubules are separated from each other. Other name of these Leydig cells, I am writing down here with the same color so that you can identify. These Leydig cells are also known as the interstitial cells. Okay. Now, why they are known as interstitial cells, I'll tell you. These interstitial cells produces a hormone that is known as the testosterone, a very important male hormone that is secreted within their body. Testosterone or androgen, other name of this testosterone is the androgen. Okay, so these Leydig cells secrete a hormone known as testosterone or androgen. Why then they are known as interstitial cells? Because the secretion of this particular hormone, that is the testosterone or androgen, is under the action of ICSH. You all have studied this ICSH. What it is? It is interstitial cell stimulating hormone. That is why they are known as interstitial cells, because the secretion of the hormone is maintained under the action of this particular ICSH. Okay, now again we will come upon to this particular figure which is there in this. Okay, now let me change the color of the marker so that you can easily get what we are going to discuss. Yes. Now, coming back onto the figure, what we have studied up till now is we have studied about this testis part, right? How this anatomy of the testis goes so that it will come out of it. Now, these seminiferous tubules now will open into another kind or another tube-like structure that is not mentioned in this figure. Why? Because otherwise the figure would have been made complicated. Okay, so what happens is, I'll explain you here. Yes, so the seminiferous tubule now will join to form, okay, I'll write it this way. Seminiferous tubule will join to form or will open into a structure that is known as retitestis. This retitestis is not given in the figure, otherwise the figure would have been made complicated. So the seminiferous tubule will open into a structure that is known as retitestis. Now this retitestis again open into, or it leads to the fine ductule that is known as vasa efferentia. Just see the spelling clearly, because it is vasa efferentia. The similar terminology is going to come up, so you need not be confused. Okay, retitestis leads to the fine ductule that is known as vasa efferentia. Now what happens is, the several tubules of this particular vasa efferentia arises from this retitestis. Okay, so these tubules leave the testis and the conduct, and it will now conduct the sperm to what is mentioned in the figure, that is this epididymis portion. Okay, so seminiferous tubule, it opens into the retitestis, then it leads to vasa efferentia, and finally it leads to what is shown in the figure, that is epididymis. This is the coil structure which is present at the posterior surface of each testis, as you can clearly see from the figure itself. Wait, I'll just again change the color so that you can get what it is. Okay. Yes. Now, this particular structure, this particular bulb, like the posterior surface that you can see in this figure, in this particular part it is very clear. This particular green markings where I have shown is this epididymis, which is located on the posterior surface of each testis. So that is how the sperms gets conducted from the testis to the fine ductules, that is known as this epididymis. Right, now what happens with this epididymis is, again I'll just draw the flow chart and I'll try to explain you. Okay, so what this epididymis goes off, now what happens, now we have to study about this epididymis part. So this epididymis contains the irregular and narrow, highly convoluted tubule that is known as ductus deferens. It is also visible in the figure. You can clearly see the figure. If at all you have tried to skip up the video and you have tried to just note down the flowchart, I am damn sure that you have missed certain points. So do not do that. We will just discuss up till here ductus deferens. From ductus deferens, we will continue in our next lecture, so that you can easily look into your books and get an idea of what we have discussed so far. Right, so how this epididymis opens? This epididymis opens into this particular structure that is in the form of this highly coiled tubule. In the figure I am marking side by side, so just have a look at where the pointer goes. Right, so this epididymis opens into this ductus deferens, that is the highly coiled narrow tubule, from where it leads to another structure that is known as vas deferens. How it leads to and what is the main role of this vas deferens, that all we are going to study in our next lecture. If you have any doubts, do ask us in the comment section or through the Gmail ID. That's all for this lecture. We will meet in our next lecture. Till then, stay safe, study hard. Bye bye. Thank you.